All right, Scott Sherman. When they say, excessive force, what do they mean by that?
Well, it's a standard by which you would say it violates the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution.
And the Fourth Amendment says...
That's the one for unreasonable searches and seizures.
Okay.
It's had its sort of its guts blown out by exemptions, which we could talk about for 4 or 5 hours. But essentially, it's this. Police officers absolutely have the right to apprehend people that they have a probable cause to arrest, that they're doing something illegal. And in effectuating that arrest...
You mean like breaking down a store and looting a store?
Absolutely.
Right, okay.
That's a crime. And when their job is to investigate crime, apprehend people as safely as they can and gather evidence. That's it. That's their job. They're not soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
But as the foot soldiers of the Constitution... See, I got that from my criminal law professor who used to teach cops as well as law students.
Mm-hmm.
Police officers are supposed to not just do whatever they feel like doing. In 1984, there was a case called Graham. Graham was a guy that had diabetes and was having sort of like a blood sugar issue, went into a convenience store and the line was too long. So he basically took his orange juice and went out in the parking lot, took it. He mm-hmm. just sort of stole it.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he should have drank it in the store. And he was acting weird. So they called the cops.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time it all got done, Graham was dead.
Mm-hmm.
And the police officer got sued for a civil rights violation, Section 1983, for violating Graham's civil rights. And the police officer won. And the reason the police officer won, so said the Supreme Court in 1984, was that there are different factors. And you have to look at it from the reasonable mind of the police officer at the time of the incident,
mm-hmm.
not 20/20 hindsight. Well,
right.
Sounds like a good idea, but... What ends up happening is there are different sort of factors involved. The severity of the alleged crime, the imminent threat to the police officer or to others. That's really the main one. And based on the Graham factor, this use of force and use of deadly force as it escalates on the police officer's reasonable position in that circumstance.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just be a reasonable citizen. You have to be a reasonable police officer. So essentially, based on the Graham factors, there was a case called Tennessee versus Garver. And the Tennessee versus Garver case was on deadly force because a kid was running from the cops, a teenager. They thought he was 18. He was 15. He jumped the fence and the cop shot him in the back of the head.
Mm-hmm.
And that cop was ruled to have violated his constitutional rights because even though he was fleeing from what they thought was a burglary
mm-hmm.
or a robbery, this one's starting to sound a little somewhat familiar, the deadly force use of shooting this kid in the back of the head was not warranted because police officers can only use deadly force if there is a significant threat of death or serious physical injury to self or others. However, if you want to take the facts and move them around, it could be argued
mm-hmm.
that deadly force might be justified in a case when a police officer is confronted by a suspect in that case. However, the first time you've ever heard anybody do anything besides pontificate or speculate about the facts of a case that we don't know anything about is on this program. That's the standard. Graham with factors and Garver.
Wait, back up again? What are you saying? You're saying
Graham factors? We're talking about law.
Okay.
We're not speculating about
okay.
what might have happened
gotcha.
Or didn't happen
so this
or
is,
bloggers.
So this going is, forward, this is going to be the standard.
Let's take these standards and hold them up against actual real facts. But let's also do something in our community. Let's understand the law. It's very simple. It's easy to read, but it's a lot of work. If we understand that the standard for police officers being a violation of people's constitutional rights is very high, you might want to criticize the Graham case because it's too subjective for the police officer.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, police officers also have to understand there is a Fourth Amendment, and you don't just get to ride up on somebody and antagonize them or start off physically violating them
mm-hmm.
because you can't use that force unless it's warranted. Just because you have a gun and a badge doesn't give you the right to do whatever you want and then charge somebody with assaulting police uniform by having the guy bleed on you when they beat him in the jail. Once you're in custody or once you've given yourself up, no matter what you are accused of, remember, the police are just there to apprehend people safely and gather evidence for the prosecution. You are to be safe.
I know. Okay.
And I don't want to talk about that case. I want to talk about going forward because there are police officers, for whatever reason, that feel as though, and certainly it's not all of them, and maybe even it's not even a large number of them. There's too many that don't have any clue that there are things that they're not supposed to do.
This is what we kind of touched on yesterday, and you brought it up whatever weeks ago. We touched on it yesterday in the board meeting, and that is, look, you really want to solve this problem in St. Louis? You really want to get to the root of the problem? And every single person, I've lived here 15 years, and every single person has said this to me from day one. And that is, in St. Louis County, we've got too many fiefdoms, right? We have too many small towns. We have too many little Fergusons and Norwood Hills and St. Anne's and this one and that one. And they all have their police force, right? And they all subsidize their existence through tickets and parking tickets and speeding tickets and tag tickets and everything else, okay? So the only way to go about fixing this is to do away with the quote-unquote town of Ferguson and to do away with the police force of Ferguson and let St. Louis County, which is a quote-unquote much more professional, much more well-run, much more established police department, because they have certain procedures that the Ferguson Police Department doesn't have the resources to go get their officers trained every 6 months on continuing education and 21st century police tactics and all those other things. So if that's the case, how many people in the last 15 years have stood up and said, hey, let's do away with a lot of these little municipalities? Nobody. Nobody wants to give up the power. So if this is the way to fix it, and the people in Ferguson don't want to give it up, and the people in Ferguson don't want to vote it out, and the people in Baldwin don't want to vote it out, and the people in Wildwood don't want to vote it out, then this is what we get.
I have no problem with Ferguson having a police force. I have a problem with Ferguson having a court. There should not be a court for every little city. There should be no police force for these places with a paid police chief and a paid mayor and a paid prosecutor for any place less than 5,000 people. And there should be this idea.
Well, Ferguson's got 20,000 people.
They should have a police force.
Should they have a court?
Absolutely not. There should be a district court that handles a bunch of those places, and they add up to a large place. St. Louis County already has 4 satellite municipal courts for the tickets that they write. They don't have 80 municipal courts for the tickets that they write. Oh, I wrote it in Creve Coeur.
But I mean,
you
already
have to go there.
They haven't even laid out what the city county reunification is going to look like. And Baldwin and all these other towns have already on record saying we don't want this to happen.
It is ripe with abuse, because what ends up happening, and it has happened, and Ferguson and Florissant together, which are larger communities, make $3.5 million in their traffic court. But the percentages of some of these little, I call them subdivision cities, they wouldn't exist if they didn't have their court. And if the folks that live in the central corridor, like me, that live in Olivet and Creve Coeur and Town and Country and Kirkwood and Webster and all these places where they don't need this traffic court revenue to survive, if they drove into North County and up and down and got tickets all the time and it was $300 or $500 for no reason, and the lawyer that you pay $100 or $200 to go to court or send something through the mail that tells you, man, you should just pay your ticket and you won't get points. If it happened to them every single day and not once a year, where they were on their way going 1 mile an hour over, or maybe doing nothing wrong.
So you're gonna tell the African American community in these towns that are predominantly African American, like Ferguson. So the way to do away with your government coming down on you is to dissolve it and have it go away.
No, get rid of its courts. And I don't care what I don't care what the racial makeup is of a police department. If every one of the officers is professional, whether they're black, white, whatever, I don't care what they are, I'm fine with that. The most important thing in our community is not race or class or social status, or shouldn't be. It's constitutional rights and respect. And there is a lack of it both ways.
We're going to get to more of that. I want to go back to that officer who was shooting the gun. We found out this morning, didn't shoot the gun, holding up the gun. We found out he has since been fired this morning from the St. Anne Police Department. I'm going to come back and talk about him in a second. America.